to enhance each other, with Drs. Carter and Larke serving as the leading scholars in their respective fields. This work and tradition of excellence is seen through the many students that have been impacted by their expertise, their mentorship, and tutelage. Today, the culmination of their collective efforts continues in the newly redesigned multicultural program here in the Department of Teaching, Learning, and Culture, and their work continues through their students who are advocates for equity, diversity, and inclusion in various capacities within the United States and across the world. On behalf of the Larke and Carter Series Organizing Committee, we thank you for joining us today. This program is made possible through the generous contributions from the College of Education and Human Development, the Claude H. Everest Jr. 47 Endowed Chair, Dr. Michael D. Miranda, the Department of Teaching, Learning, and Culture, and the Multicultural Education Program. A very special acknowledgement to Dr. James, who has worked diligently to make this program possible today and to ensure that we are all fed this evening. Also a special thank you to Lamar and Nikki's Soul Food and Barbecue Pit, also extending their services virtually amidst this pandemic. And a very warm welcome to everyone joining us this evening. Thank you.
We will now hear from Jody Ford, who is the Senior Director of Development for the College of Education and Human Development.
Well, we just had some technical difficulties. Thank you, Dr. James and Dr. Young, and the entirety of the Carter and Larke Black Education Lecture Series. I want to thank y'all again for allowing me to be just speak just a moment about, as you see on the screen, information about the new Carter and Larke Endowment, as well as the Carter and Larke crowdfunding campaign. What you'll see on your screen right there, if you have your phone, if you would just hold it up to that screen and capture that QR code, will take you to the spiritofgiving.tamu.edu, which is a place where you can make a gift to support the Carter and Larke Lecture Series crowdfunding initiative. So right now they're trying to raise $5,000 that will go on, that will continue to support this amazing event as we continue to honor these two wonderful ladies. The second slide that is up there that'll come up in just a second is should have a link to the endowment side. If that link doesn't take you to that, let me give you that. It is https://give.am/Carter-Larke. And that is, as you can see here, we're attempting to raise $100,000 so that we will have the ability to year over year, month after month, continue to keep equity and inclusion in the front, in the forefront of everything that is going on, not only in the College of Education and Human Development, but within the communities that we touch, as well as the greater Texas A&M institution. So again, that website, as a Dr. James just put on there, if you'll go to give.am/Carter-Larke. And what that will do is that will take you to that website. It'll pre-populate everything. You can help us reach that $100,000 goal. Again, also, every dollar counts. You can also go to that QR code, that QR code that's at the bottom of your screen. And that will take you to the giving website for the Carter and Larke crowdfunding initiative that we have going on right now. We have a little less than 6 weeks to reach that $5,000 goal. With everyone's help that's on this call, all almost 200 people of y'all, we know that we can do it. Thank you, and appreciate everybody's attendance tonight.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Ford, for that information. So next we will hear from Dr. China Jenkins, who is the Executive Director of Teaching, Enrichment, Advising, and Mentor Center at the College of Pharmacy and Health Science at Texas Southern University.
Can you hear me? Did I get a thumbs up? Hold on.
How about now? I tried on my headphones. Can y'all hear?
Yes, we can.
Okay, good. Howdy, everyone. I am very, very excited to be here. I'm very honored to be here. Number one, to honor the legacies of Dr. Larke and Dr. Carter, especially Dr. Carter. She instilled in me a love and a passion for the field of education. She also happens to be my mother. So I think it just kind of came naturally. So just to be at an event that honors her legacy and the work of Dr. Larke is really wonderful. But it was Dr. Alfred that directed my love of education into the field of adult education. So I was really honored just to be asked to say a few words and then to introduce Dr. Alfred. So when I think about Dr. Alfred, three things come to mind. The first one is excellence, grace, and patience. So I think about excellence because at the very beginning, when I discovered adult education, I could count on every class that Dr. Alfred taught to be excellent. Even the ones whose titles were boring or the subject I just knew I was not interested in, Dr. Alfred had a way of making it interesting because she operates at such a level of expertise. She has such great depth of knowledge that the courses that she taught just compelled you to focus and pay attention and then love the field even more. Secondly, I think about grace and patience with Dr. Alfred because during my time at grad school, I went through a bunch of life stressors between death and childbirth and other personal stressors that extended my time as a doctoral student longer than I had desired. And yet through that whole time, Dr. Alfred was very gracious and very patient with me while upholding that standard of excellence. She would not let me use stress as an excuse to turn in shoddy work or do anything like that. And so I'm feeling the repercussions of her work even now as I work with my students and as I work with faculty at my institution, and I try to instill the same love and joy of learning and work ethic and excellence that she instilled in me. So I love you, Dr. Alfred. I'm going to read your bio and we will move forward. Dr. Mary V. Alfred is a professor of adult education and human resource development in the College of Education at Texas A&M University. Dr. Alfred's research interests include international education, learning and development among women of the African diaspora, sociocultural context of adult learning, social welfare and economic disparities among low-income and low-literate adults, and issues of diversity, equity, and inclusion in adult and the workplace, in education and the workplace. She joined the faculty of Texas A&M University in 2006, and from 2009 to 2017, she served as Associate Dean and later Executive Associate Dean in the College of Education and Human Development. Since 2009, Dr. Alfred has served as a principal investigator and executive director of the Texas Center for the Advancement of Literacy and Learning, or TCAL. The center is funded by the Texas Workforce Commission to provide professional development for adult literacy educators and administrators across the state. Dr. Alfred was inducted into the International Adult and Continuing Education Hall of Fame in 2017 based on her research and leadership in the field of adult education. From 2019, the present, she served as president-elect, president, and now immediate past president of the American Association for Adult and Continuing Education, an organization that is home to the diverse population of adult educators and learners in the U.S. and beyond. Dr. Alfred received her doctoral degree from the University of Texas at Austin. It is my pleasure and my honor to introduce Dr. Alfred for the Leadership Award.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jenkins. Thank you. It's amazing and a joy to see your babies perform. Yes, you're still my baby. It's a joy. Howdy, everyone, and good evening. Good evening. I am so humbled and honored to receive this award, which exemplifies the legacies of Drs. Carter and Larke, two African-American sheroes, and I call them sheroes, in the College of Education and Human Development at Texas A&M University. When I reflect on women or just individuals who have left a legacy of service, humanity, and transformation, these two pioneers emerge at the very top of my list. For those of us in the struggle for social justice, and importantly, racial justice, equity, and inclusion, the fight is arduous and remains very personal. When I think of what Drs. Carter and Larke have left us, I am reminded of the findings of a study I conducted many, many months ago. Almost 30 years ago, my dissertation study, looking at the career experiences of tenured Black women at UT at the time. There were five in 1993. There were five Black tenured faculty at UT at the time. So I had the whole population. When I look at the dimensions of the study and the findings, and I overlay that over across Drs. Carter and Larke career history, career trajectory, again, the findings hold true for me today, almost 30 years later. The first thing I identified was self-definition. As a Black woman, as Black people, to have a strong sense of self, to be authentic in who we are, and to be, as my children call it and say it now, unapologetically Black. We make no excuses for who we are. We walk into a room and we are self-assured of who we are, what we are, who we are about. So that was exemplified in looking at their work. The second one was the power of the voice. You know, we use voice, it's an important dimension to articulate knowledge of self, for advocacy, and for bringing attention to our struggles, for also recruiting allies to fight alongside us. To achieve progress means working together with those who may not look like us, but who share our commitment to justice, equity, and inclusion. Our voice, therefore, should be inviting, not alienating. Our voice should allow others to invite us at the table. The other dimension, which I see very clearly in their work and their history, is their visibility through action. Making yourselves known through your work, your scholarship, your faculty, your service, your teaching is very, very important. We become visible not only for what we do, but the impact our work have on others. Leading with humanity, compassion, and soul, yes, I use the word soul, makes us more visible in human ways. When you look at the visibility that these two ladies have shared across their history, the impact they have had on many, many, many students and staff and also faculty colleagues, it is amazing. The other dimension is knowledge. It's an important dimension, knowledge of who you are and also knowledge of expectations. No matter what role you play, not role you hold, here at the university, know what is expected of you. Do the work and let your work speak for itself. Let your work represent you. Let your work precede you. Let your work follow you. As one of the women in my study said, we cannot half step our way through and not do the work. And at the end of the day, we don't get the required results. And we say, well, it's because of the institution. The white man did me this, the white man did me that. But you have not done the work. Do the work and rest assured that you've done the work. And Drs. Carter and Larke, they did the work. They got promoted all the way to full professor. They work with provide service. They were visible internationally. They were visible nationally. They did the work. The last dimension, is one we call bicultural, multicultural life structure. Basically, as Black people, we were forced to navigate the white world and also our Black world. We had to traverse both worlds going back and forth. And it could be daunting, and it is still very daunting as we traverse the multiple worlds. But as leaders, no matter what your racial dimension is, the world is becoming very, very multicultural. So excellence in leadership calls for us to be fluid and to move through the various cultures so that we understand our communities as we provide service and advocate for our many, many communities. So that's another important dimension. So basically, as I look across the span of these two Shiros and their work, their service, their impact, the idea of self-definition being strong Black women in their own right is very evident. Their voice to articulate oppression, to fight for advocacy, to seek allies as they did their work, their programs, that's very also telling. Visibility in the impact of their work. As I said, the students are all over the place, all over the world, in fact, continuing the work that they started. And they knew what was expected of them because they met expectations, they did the work. And most importantly, they were able to move fluidly back and forth the many cultures and structures within which they found themselves. That's why today we have these women here, we're honoring them for the legacy and the work that they have done for equity, justice in education. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Scott and Larke, and thank you, Dr. James and your committee for this wonderful event tonight.
Thank you, Dr. Alfred, for your commitment, your example, and your leadership. Congratulations again, and thank you so very much. At this time, we have a special presentation. I'd like to introduce, this is gonna be, we have some music. I told you the music hits different. By Adea Ogletree. And we're gonna cue that soon. We're getting food in all sorts of ways today, soulful food.
Get out, ooh, mountains. I'll rise like the day. I'll rise up in spite of the ache. I'll rise up and I'll do it a thousand times again. And I'll rise up high like the waves. I'll rise up. In spite of the ache, I'll rise up and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you, for you, for you. Each other, yeah. We'll rise, oh, we'll rise, oh, we'll rise. I'll rise up, rise like the day. I'll rise up in spite of the air. I will rise a thousand times again. And we'll rise up high like the waves. We'll rise up in spite of the ache. We'll rise up and we'll do it a thousand times again.
All right. Come on now, Adea. That was a Adea Ogletree, clap wherever you're at. That was amazing. Maya got me tearing up here. Miss Turner, I don't know. That was beautiful with the pictures and the singing, amazing voice. Thank you for that special song. We appreciate it. We're gonna keep moving. But again, thank you so much, Adea Ogletree, for that. At this time, I am proud to introduce my committee chair, my mentor, brother, colleague, and friend, prolific scholar, awesome person, Dr. Marlon James.
Thank you, Willie. And again, congratulations to Dr. Alford. I share with the committee that years ago when we first started talking about this event, if it had not been for her lending her support, matter of time, we were so happy when her nomination came in and it was affirmed fairly quickly. So, you know, congratulations. And I know she doesn't do the work that she does for accolades or for acknowledgments, but it was great to acknowledge her today. So thank you for that. And I hope you did get your award today. I'm here today to introduce another award winner, the Legacy of Excellence and Equity for Leadership Award, to none other than Dr. Michael Anthony D. Miranda. You all see his bio here. He's an endowed professor, our fearless leader, fearless department head. He's done any number of grant projects exceeding $10 million in funding over his career, has worked in 13 different countries. But if y'all know the man, you know that these things are not who he is. Who he is, he's a father, he's a husband, he's a granddad, he's a mentor to many of us, and he is a fearless, strategic social justice leader. The best I've seen in my entire 20-year career. So I am humbled to present this award to him today on behalf of the faculty, the students, the staff, and we are all the richer because of his efforts to promote equity, justice, diversity, not just as a number, not just as a sentiment, but as a strategic effort at acknowledging and organizing a work environment that builds up people and helps us to be the best that we possibly can be because we feel valued. And so without any further ado, I would like to introduce Dr. Michael Anthony D. Miranda for his acknowledgments of his award for leadership for equity and excellence. Dr. D. Miranda.
Thank you, and good evening, everyone. Dr. James, I'd like to extend a special thank you to you and your incredible organizing committee to deliver such an honorific program every year that gets to the heart of who we all strive to be and aspire to live in, a world of equity, a world where every single person is valued for what each of them bring in richness to our world. I want to especially acknowledge the faculty and the staff of the Department of Teaching, Learning, and Culture. They are an incredible, incredible group who committed to teaching me about their incredible work. And I want to also acknowledge Dr. Larke and Dr. Carter, who I'll give a good example. I have experienced Dr. Lark's lectures. That's where I sat in a chair in front of my glass board, as you know, in my office. And she went on in a lecture to teach me about what multicultural education is and should be. It was about my fourth or fifth, maybe day, and into my second week of tenure here, when Dr. Carter told me to drive somewhere that I've never been. I think it was off of 290 near the outlet center. And she said, be at the McDonald's at 10 a.m. And she said, be at the McDonald's, hop in, and we're gonna get into my car. And she proceeded to connect me and take me around the greater Houston area, where some of the good work that she had been doing in the past had been. I would want to also give you another appreciative example of how we are one and together. The graciousness of this evening's speaker. And Chance, I won't embarrass you, but this is how we are all connected, not only in spirit, but in soul, is yes, I can remember Dr. Lewis walking the halls as a PhD student when I was an associate professor. And so it gives me great pride to receive this recognition, but it is so humbling because of all of whom I mentioned that I have been surrounded with and blessed with being in their presence. So I want to thank each of them. I want to also congratulate the other honorees today, the magnificent Dr. Alfred, and I affirm every single spoken word that she delivered today to us. But most of all, I just want to extend a deep appreciation for the privilege of everyone's presence in allowing me to serve you. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Dr. DeMiranda. Congratulations again on your award, and thank you for your servant leadership within our department. We are just so happy and so pleased to be able to have you, because you are such a gem. Moving forward, we're going to hear next from Dr. John Williams. He is an assistant professor here in the Multicultural Education Program.
Good evening, everyone. It is my privilege today to introduce the 2021 Carter Larke Black History and Education keynote speaker, Dr. Chance Lewis. Dr. Chance Lewis is the Carol Grotnes Belk Distinguished Professor of Urban Education at the University of North Carolina at Charlotte. Additionally, Dr. Lewis is the Executive Director of the University of North Carolina Charlotte's Urban Education Collaborator and the founder of the International Conference on Urban Education. The only, key phrase, the only international conference that specifically focuses on illuminating solution-based research, service, and teaching dedicated to urban learning environments. Dr. Lewis has over 100 publications, including 70-plus refereed journal articles and the leading academic journals in the field of urban education. He has received over 7 million external research funds. To date, Dr. Lewis has authored, co-authored, and co-edited over 25 books. Dr. Lewis has a famous phrase, and some of you all know this, but I'm going to introduce some of you all to it. I am proud of you in advance. While this phrase appears simplistic in nature, the complexity and affirmation it provides is unparalleled to individuals who are fortunate enough to interact with him. This phrase has led to the growth and maturation of countless numbers of graduate students and researchers such as myself, and propel us to enter the academy as conscious, capable, and creative contributors to equitable solutions in education. He exudes excellence and is always willing to provide the critical and equitable infrastructure to support cutting-edge research. His method of systematizing challenges into solutions and passing this concept on to each graduate student he has mentored has led to not only a large number of doctoral students entering into academia, but an even larger number of graduate students of color entering into and remaining in academia. However, his reach does not end there, as he is a full believer of research and service extending past the confines of articles and books and into the communities and school districts across the United States that need it the most. To end with another famous quote of his that he often utters to all the individuals who come through his classes, someone in your hometown and across the world is waiting for your research and service to change lives and futures. Personally, there are a few individuals who embody the full ethos of this award. So, for some individuals, this is an introduction. For others, it's a reintroduction. But everyone, please give a warm welcome and a big howdy to the 2021 Carter Larke Legacy of Excellence in Equity Research Awardee, the Dr. Chance Lewis.
Thank you so much, Dr. Williams. It's just such an honor and pleasure to be back in Aggie land. So I must say howdy to everyone. So I haven't said howdy since 2011, so I had to practice. But I'm so honored to be here with you all tonight, and thank you so much for this award, the two other awardees for tonight, Dr. Alfred and Dr. DeMiranda, persons who I know very well, and I'm just proud to share this virtual stage with them on tonight in receipt of this award. And also when I get the cue to start for my lecture, the special homage to Drs. Carter and Drs. Larke as well. So, but thank you to everyone. Thank you to Dr. James and his committee. I'm just so happy to be here with all of you tonight, and I'm looking forward to the remainder of tonight's event as well.
You should be able to share your screen.
Okay. All right, so as we get started tonight, Dr. James has put me on a strict timeline of about, I think about 5 minutes he gave me to do an entire keynote. But as we look at tonight, in my few minutes, what I want to do is first lay out what I call to culminate tonight's events, to look at the title that I want us to explore, From Dreams to Reality, what I call the Carter-Lark Blueprint for Texas A&M's Role for Advancing Equity in Education. And as we look at this for tonight, for those of you who don't know me, I don't really talk about myself really at all, but I had the privilege of serving and working alongside these great scholars from 2006 to 2011 when I was at Texas A&M. And I got to see firsthand what it meant to make significant contributions to the field as well. So in the nature of today's time, in the limited time that I have, you can tweet live from this session. You know, if you hear something that resonates with you and something that you want to just revisit later, you could tweet live from this session and use hashtag Carter and Lark. But as we get started, let's give another round of applause to the namesakes of tonight's events, Drs. Carter and Lark, who have been mentors to me, who have shaped me into the person who I am today. And to make it interactive, how I was taught in the field of education, we're going to utilize the chat feature tonight on Zoom. And in your chat, I want you to just put a word in the chat that best exemplifies what these ladies have done for the field. So if they've impacted you anyway, I want you to attach a word to what they have meant to you, so they can see it in the chat, with so they can know the significance that they have. Because a lot of times in this work, you don't really get to see the significance and the impact of what you've done. So I just want you to just flood the chat with a word that highlights what they have done for you and the impact on the field as well. And we'll just let those comments roll in, and hopefully they get to see all of those as they come in as well. So as we look forward to tonight and think about all what's going on, I want us to consider a few thoughts about the impact that these, as Dr. Alfred mentioned, these sheroes of the academy. And so what I did, I reflected on their lives and really thought about what is the legacy that they left for us to carry on. So I wanted to use the blueprint analogy, because when I think about their lives, there are several key things that I want us to consider. And hopefully these factors and these stages of the blueprint will motivate the next generation to be all that they can be, because that is what they would want as well. So for tonight, in my 5 minutes that Dr. James gave me, we're going to take about 30 seconds in each one. No, I'm just kidding. But in five stages of the blueprint for what we're going to think about with leadership and equity in education, okay, that we can pull from their careers and hold on to and use that as an anchor to move forward with as well. So stage one, when you think about the lives of Dr. Carter and Dr. Larke and what it meant to Texas A&M as well, the first stage that I want us to consider from their career is the vision that they had, okay? And as we look at the vision, it's gonna be important for us not to lose focus of the vision that they had during that time at Texas A&M. So they were able to do something very few people are able to do in the academy, to navigate the academy, but not lose sight of what their true purpose was. And oftentimes we see today that most scholars, most younger scholars are just focused on one thing and trying to get promoted. But they, Drs. Carter and Lark, did not lose the vision that they had. So one of the visions that they had is they could see out from the academy and look out across the great state of Texas. They could look out across the nation and they could look out across the world and have a focus on the kind of work that they were doing. So they could look out and see the lives of Black and Brown children and say, I needed to focus and have a vision around that work. So when we think about multicultural education, when we think about urban education, they never lost sight of who they were working for as well. So they would see kids of all different shades and colors, you know, and understand that impact of what they needed to bring together to enrich opportunities for each of these students as well. So they thought about in their work is, what could I do from my role that can shape the lives of other people? So they saw people from, you know, Texas and, you know, North Carolina, you know, Illinois, and all of these states across the country. But then even way to Africa, they say, I can still see from the academy, because as I look out and examine the horizon, I know that there are populations out there that need me right now. So I wanted to capture this in something that I thought was important. If they were able to look out and see some of the inequities that were out in the field of education, how could they then tie that with their role, you know, as professors and as leading voices in that? So what I want you to do is this, watch this short clip, and I want you to think about the vision that they had. I want you to focus on the guy in the white hat. And in that, what they wanted to do is capture that even though they knew that these students had inequities that they were facing on a daily basis, they knew from their vision that they could eradicate that through their work and their contributions to higher education. So please watch the video really quick and focus on the guy on the white hat and look how a difference could be made if you really focus in on the vision. So I entered the academy at Texas A&M University, focusing on a field that is not even there yet. They had the mandate, the opportunity for the field to come to play. But as long as I had the role, when I see and look out on the inequities in the field, that's only a short barrier for me to be able to do, because I know through my work that I can make a difference. If there are any inequities, whether it be racism, privilege, social injustice, no matter what that is, I know from the platform that I have at Texas A&M University that I can do some things and produce people that can start to close any gaps or inequities that are possible for these particular students. Because I know that there's something deeper down in me that I have to do because of this opportunity. So it's really no longer about me. It's about the work that is before me, because if I do the work the correct way, one thing I know that will happen sooner or later is that the students that I put my students in front of can start to alleviate and eradicate any problems that they have. That's the vision of what we're looking at. So as we think about that, when you focus on the guy in the white hat, something happened in such a serious way. They noted that even though society put some barriers in front of them, Drs. Carter and Larke knew from their particular role that they can eradicate that. So from the field, it did not matter whether they were in Houston, whether they were in Dallas, okay, whether they were in Bryan College Station, the location didn't matter, even if they were in Africa. It did not matter what the location was. So when you think about the vision, one of the things as we kind of see in this photo that kind of floats around the internet from time to time, they knew the reality, but they didn't just want to seek equality, equity, but they wanted to seek liberation. So just think about how many people were liberated because of having an opportunity to just cross paths with Drs. Carter and Larke, okay? So as we look at this, the first thing that I want you to consider, I just have a question, okay? And I want you to think about this question for the stage one of the blueprint. What is the current vision for making the dream to become a reality that Drs. Carter and Larke brought to Texas A&M? Because they have now passed the torch to the next generation. So how will the vision be adapted to the current times and adapted to move forward for a new reality for today's time, post-pandemic, when we have seen inequities in a whole new way, but that does not stop the work as well. So stage two of what they understood in their time was the power of the brand. And what I mean by that, they understood that they were at a place, Texas A&M University, that had a powerful brand. So how they tied their vision with the brand of the university was very important. And they lived out the College of Education statement, which is at the bottom here. We are charged with transforming and enriching lives through education and health, right? So I know there are many people on here because I looked at the list of, and I see some names that I know, right? Just put a yes or a no in the chat if they have impacted you through their vision connected to the brand of Texas A&M, because when those two things came together, something powerful happened in there as well. So I want you to just think about that, and you look at how the comments are coming in through the chat, because I want us to think for the next generation, you know, how are we going to connect our vision with the brand that you have at Texas A&M University, which is a global brand as well. So here's the question for stage two of the blueprint. How will the brand that has been built in multicultural and urban education be enhanced? Because I had the opportunity to work side by side with these wonderful women who had this vision and who had an understanding of, when I connect my vision to this brand, there's no limits on where I can go as well. Next stage, as we look at this, the next thing that Drs. Carter and Dr. Larke understood was how to work it out in the system to make a difference, right? And so as we start to look at this, and Dr. Alfred alluded to this, they understood that for the full vision to become a reality, they had to progress through all the levels at Texas A&M University. You know, I had to, you know, and when you think about, I'll say for Dr. Larke first, when you think about her life and legacy to go from an instructor at Texas A&M, the first Black person to go from instructor to full professor, you know, she probably has so many stories, and some she has shared with me just as a mentee that she could tell, but I just know her like I know her. She's not going to say anything. She's just going to shake her head and just say, oh, if I just told the story. I want you to think about what that means inside of, she understood that she had to work through the system to get to the point so the full vision to be carried out. Or if you take Dr. Carter to be the first Black person to hold an endowed chair at Texas A&M University. Think about the stories that went along with that, but you could not do some of the things that you're doing if you don't work it out through the system to advance through the ranks to make a difference. So as we start to look at that, even though they advanced through the ranks, they did not forget what the goal was, liberation for the communities that were important to them as well. So I want us to think about what that means in today's context. Junior faculty that are on here and others aspiring to be faculty members in higher ed, you know, as Dr. Alfred said, you can't have any excuses. You have to do the work, and the work will set up future opportunities for each of us to advance as well. So the question is, how will the current work that is being done that has equity and education as a focal point be valued in the tenure promotion system? Because if you think about the legacy that these ladies had to leave for us, as you think about insider promotion and tenure rooms with equity and education and multiculturalism and urban education was not widely accepted by everyone in the room, right? And they still advanced their scholarship to the point of making a difference. So as we look at this and as equity and education continues to evolve in racial injustice and all of these factors that we see, how will you work through that to still advance your work in today's time as well? Stage four, really quick. One thing they also understood for the vision to become a reality, they had to recruit and graduate equity leaders. Now, Dr. Carter, she is the recruitment queen, right? She recruited people from everywhere. Far and wide, near and far, you could be from around the corner or around the world. You're coming to Texas A&M. I'm gonna recruit my kids. I'm gonna recruit everybody, you know, to come to Texas A&M because I wanna make sure that everybody gets access to this opportunity. You know, Dr. Larke, they understood that getting people in the door, removing barriers, giving access, right, was the key to making sure the vision went forward. So not only do we recruit you, we're going to graduate you as well. And as you start to look at this, you know, I know that there are people right on the call right now who have either been recruited by Dr. Carter or recruited by Dr. Larke. And if that is you, I just want you to put something in the chat so they can see that that was you, because they understood that part of their role, okay, and not being selfish, just to make sure that we have the opportunity to recruit people to come to Texas A&M to be part of something bigger as well. So they recruited, they didn't care who you were, how you looked, we're gonna get you in the door and out of the door as well. And look, people putting in, I'm a Carter recruit, you know, and as you start to look at that, that's very important as well. So the question is then, what are the systems of support that will be in place to recruit the next generation of equity leaders to serve Texas and the global community? So when I remember when I first moved to College Station as a faculty member, the first person at my door was Dr. Larke to greet me and my family with some food, to hug us and say, welcome to Texas A&M. I didn't even know where the buildings were yet and all of that, but she still did that. And those are the things that are important for us to consider for the next generation as well. So as we look at this, in my final stage of the blueprint, they understood that they had to be a champion for equity. And when we look at this, when I talk about a champion of equity, they constantly thought about some things like this particular questions, innovation in academic programming. They understood that you just could not have just any program. You had to be innovative in the programming. So as you start to look at it, we want students to come to College Station, or like Dr. Carter, it doesn't matter. We'll have class in Houston, we'll have it in Dallas, we'll have it in Africa. It doesn't matter. We're gonna have class wherever it needs to happen because we're gonna be innovative. But here's the question I want us to consider for today's time before we wrap up here. In today's time, you cannot have students just come in one direction. You cannot just have students coming to College Station. What will be the new delivery methods that you utilize to make sure that you have? How will you enhance online? How will you be on the ground in these key places in the state that you are charged to serve as a public institution? What will be the A&M presence in Houston with a dedicated location to serve people that you are missing that can't come to College Station? How does that look? How does it look in Dallas? How does it look globally? What will be innovative that you bring to the table? How will you serve educators with things other than degree programs? What about certificate options and all of these things that are now available that you can advance the work in as well? So as we get ready to close, I want you to think about the future directions about the impact on equity in education. You're at a fork in the road, and you want to keep the legacy that these two sheroes started for this great institution. And what we want you to think about as you start to move forward is this particular question. Who now is ready to carry the torch, right, and lead A&M to continue as the national and international leader in urban and multicultural education? There is not an option of if it should be done. The blueprint has been set. And what we want you to think about in closing for tonight is that the legacy, these living legends that are with us today, would want nothing but the best for these programs going forward in the future as well. So I'm out of time. So I want to just thank you for allowing me to share a few words about the blueprint of these sheroes who are living legends as well. And I'm so honored that we are honoring them through this lecture series to make sure that their contributions are not forgotten as we start to look at the work that is ahead of us today. So continue to fight the good fight, keep your eyes focused on the vision, and then also utilize the great brand that you have at Texas A&M as well to keep moving forward. So thank you so much. It is an honor, pleasure to be back in Aggie land again. So I will close out with the words, howdy, and thank you again. Take care.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lewis, for your words of wisdom. Everyone give him a round of applause, please. Dr. Lewis, we thank you. And I'm like a graduate student back in class again, because often I left with more questions than I do answers with Dr. Lewis because of how he presents things. He makes you think deeply. So that he's left us a lot to think about as we approach this fork in the world. We appreciate the understanding of that blueprint. I'll be calling you for that PowerPoint so that we can continue to process that as we develop the new multicultural education program. But we appreciate your insight, your expertise, your candid way of teaching about very complex issues. We also want to congratulate you again on being a recipient of the Legacy of Excellence in Equity for Research this year. And that award, it was delayed because of the storm we hit here last week, but there's a beautiful award heading your way. Y'all didn't see it. Dr. Damaranda and Dr. Alford also received some very nice awards tonight to their homes. So let me say, as we transition to Dr. Carter and Larke, again, we want to congratulate Dr. Alford, Dr. Damaranda, Dr. Chance Lewis for their legacy of accomplishments in receiving these awards tonight. I personally want to thank the committee for, you all don't understand how complicated it was to plan a virtual event in a state that didn't have power last week. But there are people who have worked tirelessly behind the scenes. And amidst COVID, when we have some of our colleagues out, some not well, some people didn't have power, some people didn't have water. But you know, all we had to do was ask, and people were texting, they were jumping in. And I want to say thank you to all of them. This event would not be possible if not for the community of faculty, staff, and students who come together every year to do this. And having done it amidst a pandemic and with a power outage and a winter storm last week, and we got soul food today, I want to congratulate the committee on just being organized and being thoughtful. And for our multicultural family, love you. And we want to transition now quickly to our two honorees for tonight. We love to remember them every year. So we want to bring up the woman responsible for us even having the opportunity to have multicultural at Texas A&M, to even have these conversations in these spaces. And then the eminent faculty of faculty, Dr. Novella Carter. We want Dr. Larke to say a few words, and then we'll conclude with Dr. Carter as tradition. But we want to thank everyone for your time and attention tonight. We'll turn it over to Dr. Larke for a few words.
Well, hello and good evening. This has been one of the most outstanding days since retirement. As you can see from my background picture, that is my pecan orchard. We have 100 pecan trees. So I will just let you know that I continue to do diversity in South Carolina. I have a variety of pecans. But let me say to you, as I thought about just a few words to say, I'm reminded of what Novella said to me in one of our visits to Chicago. One of the Chicago mayors had recently passed, and she was saying that, you know, there is no one to take that person's place, and I won't call that name. And so as I thought about it, I said, what will happen when I leave Texas A&M? You always try to leave a place better than you found it. And it is through the students. As Martin Luther King has often said, we may not get to the promised land together, but surely you will be coming. And that's because diversity has been such an integral part of my entire being that I could not even think of anything else to study. I remember when Novella came, Novella and I met, and being at Texas A&M for such a long time, being the only lonely, I said, this is not about to happen. So we met at a conference. And from that, we became friends. Novella came down and took a class with me. I still have the quilt that you made at that class. And then as she became a part of her own, people often wonder, well, why is she in urban ed and you in multicultural ed? Because she had a destiny. Her destiny was urban ed. But she realized that multicultural ed was the umbrella. And so we began to do workshops together. We began to study together. We began to write together. But we knew, as Dr. Alfred and Dee Miranda and also Chance, we had a vision. We were not going to be there forever. So that's why we strategically went to recruit. And like many of you, I said, well, Novella, you're gonna bring in all of those students. I think one year we had 30 students. We didn't realize that they changed the whole dynamic of classes in the College of Education.
It was 35, Dr. Lark.
35, okay. Not only did we go to Houston, we went to Laredo, we went all the way around. Because we realized that, as Chance said, Texas A&M had a brand. I will always be thankful for Texas A&M. I'm still waiting on my lunch date from my colleagues, but that's okay. You know, that's my running joke. But what it allowed me to do was to stay focused on my research and to have opportunities to be able to transform lives. Because once you get into the discipline of multicultural education, it's almost like once you've been saved, you're not going back. Because it's about the children. And our role is to make sure that each and every child have an opportunity to learn, to be creative. And we are only become vessels. And so I say to you tonight, I am proud of the work that you've done, but you always have to stay focused on the goal. Learn how to keep your teaching, research, and service all connected together and let it be a part of your life. And always know that you have a role to have the place better than what you have left it, to find it better than what you have left it. And so thank you. We are just enjoying retirement, as they say retirement, but you know, just today I was editing an article for a student. So, you know, you just continue to work, and much blessings to each and every one of you. And Chance, you know, I met you when you was a graduate student in Colorado. Everywhere I was given the charge as an NCATE person to do the diversity. And guess who name kept coming up? Chance Lewis. So when he got an opportunity to come to Texas A&M, we knew that it would be. And sometimes you come and you stay for a little while, but then you go out and explore more. I remember seeing John. He didn't know I was sitting in the room. I don't think he really knew who I was, per se. But he presented his information in such a manner that I know that it would be good. See, when you're on your way out, don't be selfish. Continue to go along with the journey, because it is a journey of life. So when your days are there, enjoy it. Enjoy the opportunity. Texas A&M will be around when we're no longer here, but your legacy will continue because you have it. And again, thank you for over the 100 and some people. And Marlon, now you know, I didn't get my soul food dinner today.
I apologize to you, ma'am. I apologize.
Okay, we're gonna talk about that.
Yes, ma'am.
You know, as teachers, you know, you're always in a teachable moment. But thank you again.
You're welcome. Anytime. Dr. Carter?
Hello, everyone. As my sister scholar says, Pat Lark, this is a wonderful, wonderful evening. Every single thing about it has been wonderful. And I'm so happy to see my colleagues who I love. And I love them so because they know it's all about the students. It's all about the students. And, you know, I appreciate every single person for being here. The award winners, you deserve it. All three of you, you deserve it. Dr. DeMiranda, Dr. Chance Lewis, Dr. Mary Alford, who brought my daughter through to her doctorate. All of you, you deserve it. You deserve it. And Chance Lewis was on that committee as well, you know, and you live to see the fruit of your labor. And that is what it is all about. And I just, you know, I charge you to do some of the things that Chance had in his lecture for you tonight. All of those things are so pertinent, you know, and they talk about me being the recruitment queen. That was because I knew I had a short window to give students who were underrepresented access. And I even call those who were in urban education underrepresented. You know, if they were Black, Hispanic, white, whatever they were in urban education, they were underrepresented. And I recruited them too. And the reason I was so passionate about it is because my mother was valedictorian of her eighth grade class, but she could never go on, not even to high school, let alone higher education. She did not have access. She did not have the opportunity. So when I got into higher ed, my main goal was, how do I give access to those who have never had it before, or to those who serve people that masses don't particularly care for? And not only recruiting them, but you know, Dr. Larke and I spent a whole lot of days, Chance Lewis too, how do we get them through? How do we get them through? We've had some three-person committee meetings about how do we get the students through? How do we support them? How do we help them? How do we love on them? How do we be tough? How do we, you know, crack the whip when we need to crack the whip? When do we crack the whip? When do we speak in love, and when do we get tough? You know, those are things that we have to know. It's all part of bringing them through, helping them to transform. So this has really, really been so wonderful. And I am just proud to say that Texas A&M was the highlight of my career. Texas A&M really allowed my career to soar. I have to just say it, it allowed my career to soar. And I am so proud that I am Professor Emerita, you know, that means for life, y'all, okay? So you got me for life, you got me around for life. And if I live to be 90, I'll still be trying to chime in and wave at you, okay? So this has just been a wonderful, wonderful evening. And I just want to say that Pat and I we're calling each other sister scholars. We have passed the torch on to some wonderful, competent, brilliant, fantastic scholars. We have passed the torch on. We have hope in you. We have confidence in you. We put a lot on the line to help carve that path, okay? And we know you will never let us down. You're doing marvelous, wonderful things in the department, in the college, at the university, in the state, in the nation, and the world. And you know, we're very proud of everybody. We're very proud of you, and we applaud you. And so we just want to thank you for this marvelous evening, marvelous evening. And we're just like Pat said, she just finished up on the edit one. I just finished writing an article, and I thought, why am I writing this article? What am I doing this for? I'll tell you this, when you retire, it does not mean that your brain shuts down, okay? And we're still publishing, we're still engaged, we're still, you know, we can't run, but we can walk fast, okay? So we are just happy to be in your presence, and we applaud you, we commend you, we love you. Have a great evening.
Well, that concludes our event. We love Dr. Carter, Dr. Larke, Dr. Alford, Dr. Lewis, and Dr. Dave Miranda. We appreciate everyone coming and joining us for the Carter and Larke Black History and Education Lecture for 2021. To the committee, we thank you guys for all of your efforts. And please visit the websites that the university has set up to donate to this effort. By achieving our funding goals, we will extend these equity lectures throughout the entire year. And we know that work is so critical within the state of Texas and so critical across the nation. We thank you. We love you. Everyone stay safe. And until next time, Take care.
Marla, may I say one other thing?
Yes.
You know, I'm a firm believer that no one has to give you anything, but I do want to thank you and the committee and all of you who have participated. Thank you sometimes seems like a small word, but it's out the generosity that you have decided to do this. No one is entitled to promote you. No one is entitled to just say to you, you've done a good job. But Novella and I really thank you for all the efforts, and Jody and all of them, and Dee Miranda and all of you who have taken out of your busy schedule to end this Black History Month. But we all know that it's a Black History Year. And so again, please, thank you, thank you, thank you.
Amen to that.
Amen, y'all.
Thank you, thank you.
Everybody be safe and take care.
All right.